Is that what you really, really want to do more than anything else in the world?
You gotta find your own voice.
And the architectural profession was just not doing anything to advance. The practice of architecture today is anything you choose. Your job as a graduate is to figure out what you want that to look like.
Can't beg for the honey.
Have you ever wondered what other careers you could pursue with a degree in architecture?
A very good morning, ma'am.
Morning. Can you hear me, guys?
Yeah. A very good evening to everyone. We are extremely happy to welcome you all to the third session of Archcult Musings, the Archcult 21 guest lecture series. With our theme as dimensions this year, we are exploring the various niches that influence and are influenced by architecture. So we'd like to thank each and every one of you being here with us today. On this occasion, we would also like to thank our sponsors, our travel partner Red Taxi, graphic design partner Vacuum, our online publicity partner RK Voice, photography partner Indian Institute of Photography, and our workshop partner Carmen, Epocher and Prayer.
I would like to introduce our guest of the evening, the CEO of Stellar Amenities, Space Architect, Architect Anastasia Prosina. Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, guys. Thank you for having me. So excited.
Thank you for being here, ma'am. So, architect Anastasia Prosina is an award-winning aspirational futurist and practitioner in space architecture, the nascent field of helping people thrive in small spaces in outer space. She is the founder and CEO at Stellar Amenities, a company with the mission of complementing space habitats with lightweight, deployable, and reconfigurable elements to support well-being in space. Architect Anastasia received a bachelor's in urban design from Novosibirsk State University of Architecture, Design and Art. She holds a master's in space architecture from Sasakawa International Center for Space Architecture in proximity and collaboration with NASA Johnson Space Center in Houston. She has been involved in numerous space projects from designing lightweight interior habitation structures for the Tesserae self-assembling space station at MIT Media Labs Space Exploration Initiative to working on an Iceland-based Martian analog habitat commissioned by Mars Society. Her other places of work include aerospace company Excalibur Almas, Fourth Planet Logistics, and Galactica Space. We are very excited to receive an insight into your journey and your experiences. So over to you.
Thank you, Neil. Thank you so much, guys. Let me just share my screen and I will start my presentation. One moment. I haven't used this system much. So you see my screen, right?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
All right. Okay, how do I change the tab? Okay, one second. All right, you see it, right?
Yes.
Guys, thank you, Archcult, for having me. It's such a pleasure to speak with you today. I'm so excited to share my insights and, you know, to give you like some perspective on what exactly is going on in space architecture and how you guys can get involved. And there's just so much opportunities coming along and I'm just so excited to share it. You know, the biggest thing that, let me start with the definition of space architecture. So space architecture is the it's the theory of practice of designing and building inhabited systems and inhabited places in outer space, meaning that it's not only, you know, space habitat structures itself, you know, in terms of systems engineering, but also it's something that goes inside of space habitats. And this is what my company is focused on. Designing the human-centered solutions for those who will go to the Moon and Mars to live not just for a few days, but to stay there for long periods of time. And as you know, that there's so many things going on in the private space sector. As you know, that Inspiration 4 just over 1.5 months just launched to space, stay there for 3 days, and you know, Axiom Space Station is building a private space station, and also NASA's recent solicitations on a commercial live destination also opens up, you know, for new space stations in orbit. I recently saw news from NanoRax as well as many other US-based companies, and also outside of US, that are planning to build space stations. So I calculate it's going to be around like four or five stations in orbit by the end of like 2030. Again, like the reason why I'm pointing out on the private space sector, because in private space, they have, you know, we have a client that actually pays for going to space versus astronauts who actually get paid to go to space and they don't really get to choose how they want to live and where they're going to, you know, how their environment going to look like. They have really minimal control on this, but in when you actually pay going to space and you pay a lot of money, you can see that designs of these capsules are really different. They look great, they're aesthetically pleasing, and it's just because to really evaluate the experience of being in space. And Musk has booked a ticket on one of the Virgin Galactic flights, so it's just also good news. But the reason why I told you is that while we have the short period missions, right, to the orbit or low Earth orbit or parabolic flights, suborbital flights, there is still a question how exactly we can sustain long duration missions. Because as we all think about getting back to the moon and not just visiting it, but also staying there, how exactly we want to ensure that people will be able to, you know, live there sustainably in long duration, in long period of time. And even NASA is saying that two of the most critical issues of human access to space is, you know, the first is radiation protection. Like, we still scientists trying to figure out what exactly we want to use for radiation protection. And the second is psychological effects of confinement and isolation. So this is like, it's really serious because it's like the second biggest problem after radiation. Excuse me. And space architecture can solve it. So imagine like solving one of the biggest problems in the multiplanet, like on of humanity becoming multiplanetary species. This is really huge. I will go deeper into what exactly happens to a human body in space. So we have lack of gravity loading, meaning that the muscles don't really build up and your bones weaken. You have some problems with eyes, your vision becomes less, you know, doesn't work as well as on Earth. And especially if you're thinking about the Moon and Mars, you know, in low Earth orbit, you're still connected to Earth, you still can see Earth from the window of cupola, for example. But in some long duration missions, you won't be able to see it. And you won't be able to relate yourself to like the rest of humanity and feeling kind of separate and isolated in even a high, in a bigger scale. As we all know that, you know, during the pandemic, like what happened is that, you know, we sat home and it just, it felt so natural. And then like, it was really tough. And this, like thinking about in this perspective, in terms of like astronauts going to the Moon and Mars, this is going to be even like 100% time, 100 times more harsh. Again, you have limited privacy, floating. So the sensation of floating restricts, it really makes astronauts having a hard time falling asleep. Around 90% of astronauts reported that they have problems of falling asleep. They usually take medications. I actually know only one astronaut who told me that he actually enjoys sleeping in weightlessness. His name is Tori Musgrave. He's a veteran of the, he flew on all the shuttle missions. So he told me that he actually enjoys, he said that he was born to float in space. So he really enjoys sleeping in it. And the other thing is hygiene, also biggest part. So there's much, you know, especially like thinking about behavioral changes and psychological changes. Again, like you live in a small place with people that you didn't choose to go. Usually the agency choose who you will go to meet the complementary skills with your teammates. So again, like missing the family, feeling really pressured in private space. This is something that we want to address in long duration missions. And like looking the current space station, whenever I look at this picture, it makes me so sad. So we have artificial light that, you know, some artificial light can replicate the sunlight pretty easily, but this one is like, really looks like kind of hospital light. Visual disorder, you see that there's this crowdness. You can't really find out where exactly is what, but I guess the astronauts pretty much familiar with their space, but in the future of space flight, actual future that's upcoming right now, it's going to be different. And you want to really pay attention on all these problems. And well, I'm not blaming the space station looks the way it is, because that was the reason why it looks this the way it is, you know, bringing all the equipment all the time, making sure that experiments, science experiments are run in good conditions. And so it's like really created the crowdness. So they didn't really plan on the kind of storage storage acumen. They didn't plan on how exactly you want to place all the equipment. So the smells, if you heard space smells like a burnt barbecue, it's how astronauts describe it. And especially like there's this problem of equipment and the bathroom that is kind of next to sleeping quarters. So again, like as we all know in architecture, you want to make sure that these noisy facilities are kind of separated from where you want to rest. And so it's like it's you know, architecture can bring us a lot of lessons to and inform how we can design for space habitation. So lack of color, lack of natural stimuli. There's something about, you know, natural stimuli being as, you know, humanity being in nature that supports our well-being. So it's something that would be great to incorporate. So design is not just about aesthetics, it's about making sure that astronauts are working efficiently and they can find, basically can find a tool that is that is, you know, fast to find. This is where design can help. Enhancing psychological functioning. This is how astronauts sleep. Some of the astronauts who are staying less than 6 months in space station, they sleep like that. Astronauts that stay longer than 6 months, they have a separate crew quarters, but basically they have more privacy, but the structure, the sleeping bag that you see, they're pretty much the same. Again, like it's all about making sure that design can enhance the interaction between crew members to minimize conflicts, because again, if there's a conflict arise, there's a big chance that you can jeopardize the entire space mission, meaning that, you know, government spend so much money and you just, you know, failed because of some kind of conflicts in the team. It cannot happen. Enhancing social cohesion. Again, they have a place where they have dinner, they have breakfast like us, right? And they have designated table. Which funny, you know, it's funny that to think that table doesn't really need to be there because it's weightlessness, right? But it's still this symbol of connecting with each other. It's still making sure that people, like, you know, astronauts, they get along, they chat with each other because they have so many tasks in space. Yeah, reducing stress, making sure that there's like team building kind of activities that design can also enhance. There's some ideas on like how you make sure that the space that they live is going to be extremely small for the next like 20 years. I tell you, you know, and you can enhance at least, you know, LED surfaces, like really playful experience and, you know, smart surfaces that are antimicrobial, by the way, because one of the biggest concerns also of like designing for space is making sure that material is easy to clean. Better if you don't need to maintain it, so it's like self-cleaning material, and also it's lightweight and it's can be stored in a small space when it's launched and then deployed in its supposed size. So this is like an example, kind of a mood board for how can space station can look. I mean, obviously this is not space station. So we have natural light that enhances productivity and improves well-being, complexity and order. You know, it looks like the patterns of nature can enhance our well-being too, according to some research. Water stimuli, again, we wouldn't be able to have a waterfall for obvious reasons. But, and also water is going to be something that was scarce, but maybe like a projected water on the wall might work. Natural sounds like birds. So again, like what astronauts miss so much being in space is the sounds of nature, the sounds of like ocean, the sound of birds, the sound like being pretty much outside, because you cannot really be outside in space unless you do EVA, but you're still like in a spacesuit that is actually a spacecraft. Like the complexity of spacesuit is that it's pretty much a spacecraft, but it's smaller. You know, visual connection to nature, material connection. So it's really something that we're looking into while redesigning for space architecture, spacecraft. So in my company does like what goes inside, designs what goes inside of space habitation, because we believe that this is where we can imply a lot of imagination. There is much less restriction than if you design entire space habitat. So we work as a supplier, as a contractor to companies that own space stations or somehow like provide experiences for tourists. There are many companies already coming along that it's kind of this marketplace for like for all the space experiences. You just can go ahead and book a ticket. So we work with those providers. So our focus is the, you know, we focus on two users, the national astronaut and the private astronaut. And really understanding what are the differences, the key. Because as I mentioned, that astronauts, the biggest thing for them is to perform even more, like perform even better, and to make sure that the design is intuitive and it's easy to work with it. And for private astronauts, it's all about shield, it's all about the experience, and it's all about like what exactly you will do in space, what exactly will attract more people going to space. So we will see like, you know, as we see more and more people spending millions of dollars into space, it will mean that the market will build up, meaning that the missions of national astronauts will also prosper. So that's really a good question. You guys, I will give you a really short overview of my projects that are done in my company. But I probably will finish in around 5 minutes, and then I'll be open to questions, because I think that the biggest part of any conversation is question and how it can be really helpful to you guys. So this is this analog habitat in Iceland that I partnered with Mars Society and the Forest Plant Logistics, and it's this inflatable, oh wow, the video is gonna work actually. Because usually it doesn't work. this, again, like the biggest principles in space architecture is making sure that it can be, you know, transportation. Like you first think about transportation, how exactly it can be transported, what kind of rocket you're going to use, where it's going, like how many people are going to be on the mission. So it's like, and then meaning that if there's going to be 4 people on the mission, like how many supplies you want to have. So you always calculate everything. And so this habitat is inflatable habitat that was developed for a lava tube inside of one of the Icelandic caves, lava tubes. And it's extremely lightweight. Okay, 1 second. Yeah, so this is the view how like it looks like when it's placed. This is the interior design. Why it goes back? Okay. Rather strange. So the biggest design issue we had is to how you place this in lava tube, because in order to place something big in lava tube, you want to think about transportation, and there's like lava tubes are really different sizes and shapes, and you and there's no such technology exists, like no such robotics exists that can bring something that is there. And another problem is lava tube exploration is, you'll have radiation protection. But the problem is you want to do a lot of things on the surface. So like getting back and forth from this habitat that you place in lava tube might cause a lot of problems. Especially if it's like a really rocky cave. I think it was a really good exercise. Unfortunately, the project wasn't funded, and this is pretty much really typical in space architecture. So you want to make sure that you find good investors and partners to make sure that it gets implemented. But even with this instrument, even with these resources, we still there's a higher chance since it will never be implemented. But now the time have, you know, they're changing, and we will see more and more designers and architects coming joining the space architecture movement and just being able to implement their stuff and just see it in space. This is the coolest thing, I think. So 2018, 2019, I was working with a company, a Houston-based company called Excalibur Almas. It possessed a flown solid space station. And I remember the founder of Excalibur Almas said, well, okay, you're Russian. You probably will know what exactly you will do with the space station. I said, well, yeah, absolutely. No idea. So here we were challenged to complement the space station with two different conflicting users, researchers and the private astronauts, meaning tourists, right? How exactly you can differentiate those users, what exactly their goals and needs. So for tourism, it's want to have a unique experience, obviously, like take great pictures, paint in space, have some music, and have some kind of assistant to support. Well, it's usually optional, because as you look at the Inspiration 4, they were able to go there without any assistance. Well, kind of, maybe from the, you know, from the ground control. In terms of research side, you want to make sure that astronauts are working efficiently and effectively, as already mentioned before. So it's like they don't really prefer to have big space. Well, you see again, like they don't get paid to have a big space, right? Here is this exposure view of a space station that we designed. So we wanted to make sure that those functions that are the loudest ones are separated from the place where you will sleep. Here is this contractory where you sleep. It's kind of this convertible car. If you think about the structures, it's replicates convertible car roof. And you have here like a storage for, you know, collapsible research boxes for research. But here you have like a galley where you, there's table where you get some food, but also there is like some amenities like drinks for tourists. Okay, so guys, this is the research boxes that I explained. So they're storable in the size, and you can put cushion on the top. I know it might not make sense because you cannot sit in space, but some people like to replicate like the feeling of being home, and even though you can't really sit, you can strap and sit, right? So this is like this rotatable smart mobile screen, which can be used as a kind of this connections ground control, like communications ground control. And this is the convertible surface. This is the all information you can find on the website. I'm just be really short in here. So the Martian chair and design is a part of my program at the Sakai International Center for Space Architecture. And designing a chair is something really iconic, because many like star architects, they designed the chair that as their like a character, as their statement. But for us, it's just really about how space analogs look right now. They use like office chairs that we're not going to use on Mars, or 100% no, because they're extremely heavy. They're not designed for sitting on Mars. The biomechanical posture of sitting on Mars is different. They pretty much, you know, and it's not light, you know, so this, we designed the 1/6 of the weight of the office chair, and it's like deployable, and it has this weird shape, but this weird shape is for really assisting the posture on sitting on Mars, because Martian gravity is 1/3 of the Earth gravity, so the posture will be different. It's all about making sure that's lightweight, reconfigurable. Like if you can use it in the multiple cases, it's deployable. But also you want to make sure that it's not flammable. Because what would be a pity if it burns really easily? Easy to maintain and doesn't do off-gassing. Again, like it's enclosed habitat, and you don't want to have any gases of plastic to, affect your health. And this is like this research. Well, there's so much assumption. Even NASA doesn't know how to design a chair for Mars. And there's like assumptions I did with the astronauts. Like we have 0G gravity posture, which is like this light blue outline. It has like 130 degrees of the open body posture. Earth gravity is like this, the red one, the red outline, and the Martian posture is somewhere in between. Again, like we wanna, so my company is planning to do some research to test this theories and on the parabolic flight, that, you know, if you heard of the zero G plane, which replicates parabolas, like replicates zero G Martian gravity and lunar gravity, due to its trajectory goes like that. And whenever he goes like up or down, this is when you feel like weightlessness or other gravities. So it's really minimal approach, like making sure that this bag, it's supports different sitting positions to really amplify experience of being on Mars. I mean, I think it will get really boring because like after living for a long time, there's going to be something that, you know, you will look forward to. Even like playing with the chair is going to be something really bring you a lot of joy. Minimal amount of material, minimal volume that's when stored. Okay, this is how it stores. So it's like really small, yet the cushion still supports. So it's like it's not a camping chair. It's pretty comfortable chair for work. The Tesla interior design, I was invited as a visiting researcher to MIT Media Lab to work on the self-assembling space habitat. This one, it was designed by researchers at MIT. So basically the principle works like that. You pack the tiles in a rocket flat, and then once it's deployed, like released to space, there are sensors on these tiles that self-connect to each other and creates an entire space habitat. The benefit of this approach is to really save space inside of rocket, so meaning a saving cost, but then like really creating a big structure that can host up to 8 people inside. So usually like it's like 2 people, but now it's like 8 people, so it's like a lot of space. And this is like the proposed structure. So Gateway, it's a space station that is NASA designing for, and other partners designing for the lunar orbit, and this is like how it's going to be connected. That's the artistic expression, obviously. This is like, I would say that like when you work in space architecture field, you have really limited time. Well, I mean, in general, in architecture and design, you like sometimes you have really tight deadlines. So this is like, I had like really 3 weeks to develop a concept and then like something that is workable. So this is like the inside of a space habitat. Like if you take out the tiles, so we have a core, habitation core in the middle, like you can host up to 8 people inside. And this entire habitat is designed not as a free flyer, but as a module you connect to a space station for the influx of crew. So if you want to host more people, you connect to the space station, I mean this module. The galley that replicates the tile surface, research racks that are really easily assembling, and you can create different like research based on the research racks, connectivity with. And then you have meditation corridor. It's something really interesting because, with the advent of all these several being apps on like meditation. I thought that it would be really neat to have it. And again, like you won't be able to really meditate. You will be able to just trap yourself into the wall. But I think it's just mostly about a private place where you just go and read the book. And I think this will be pretty crowded because the window is just so cool here. Yeah, it's artistic expression. I think I have more renders on the website right now, but this is pretty much the research that we've done. We continue working on this project, like we want to build it as a mock-up for the Venice Biennale, Architecture Biennale next year. So I'm really looking forward to it. So anyways, guys, I'm really open to questions. I was trying to be as fast as possible to hear what questions you have so I can answer your questions and just really help you with anything, if there's anything you help, right? So you can follow us on Facebook, LinkedIn, and we have Instagram. But yeah, you can, if you have any questions, you can feel free to email me. It's my email. And yeah, looking forward to your questions. Thank you, guys.
Thank you very much, ma'am. All your works were very informative for us, and it was very new for us too. And for giving us a whole new perspective on the way we see the space architecture. I'm sure every one of us is very inspired by all that you have shared with us. And also we have some questions for you from, we collected that from that students. So mm-hmm. Yeah, we want to hear so much from that.
So thank you, ma'am, for that wonderful presentation. So I'll be moving on to a few questions we've collected for you. So all these come from our students. So moving on to the first question. So it's basically about how you made the transition from architecture into space architecture. As in, during your bachelor's degree, when did you like feel that this is what you want to do? And how did you sustain and work towards that interest?
What's the third question? How did I sustain work?
Your interest towards space architecture, because that is not what is commonly there in the syllabus. So
that's a really great question. And I think it would be really helpful to see my, you know, to have my perspective on how you become like an architect, like transition from designer and architect towards someone that designs for outer space, right? So I was like a student, right? Bachelor, like a undergrad student in urban planning, like third year of my school. And I was I traveled to Moscow. I mean, I pretty much do it pretty often. Why not? I mean, at that time I was living in Russia, and I stumbled upon an exhibition of a Soviet space architect. Her name is Galina Balashova. She designed all of the interior designs for space stations, like Salyut, Mir, pretty much like wherever flown by Soviet Union. She designed it. She also designed some logos, the patches, pretty much everything. She was like the main designer of everything, and she was really under secret until 2015. In 2016 I attended the exhibition. And so what inspired me is that she is extremely masterful watercolor artist, and she was like working mostly as an artist, less than an architect, I would say. I mean, it's kind of interconnected, right? But I found that her drawings of interior designs, they're so like intricate. They're so the human body, there is like kind of this interconnected piece of entire system, if you know what I mean. So without this architecture, human being won't be able to survive in a vacuum of space. Like, you will die instantly without the supporting system. And this is pretty much this architecture that you, like interior design architecture that astronauts see. It's pretty much what they see almost 100% of their time in space. So I thought, well, that's so great, because not only you want to create something that astronauts see and look all the time and can affect their well-being and how they work, but also the design, it's like you can't really make any mistakes. You can't really send something that is not going to be used. It should be multi-purposely used. It should be like efficient. It should be like, with the mission towards supporting human life in space. This is really what inspired me so much. I was like looking, there was like a dummy, like in a spacecraft. It was kind of a mock-up, and I thought, oh my God, it's so cool because this is a person, like, and it's like the environment is so small. And I thought, well, but this is in the environment that will make us a multiplanetary species. And why it's important to me, it's not just about exploration, but also, you know, you don't want to end up like dinosaurs. I mean, we want to make sure that some part of humans at least will be able to spread away from Earth and spread the seeds of humanity. So this is how I think about it. So at that time I thought, oh, that's so great, but I couldn't, like, I was Googling like space architecture, you couldn't find any information, only like this Circumferential Center for Space Architecture, and then there's like some articles, but usually space architecture implied, you know, something in architecture, and then you use space as like this space, not outer space. So I thought, well, okay. But I'm so committed, I'm so interested in this, I want to go ahead and learn more about it. And it sounds like the only place I can learn is this, if I will get this master's in space architecture in Houston. And then I began preparing for it. I didn't have money, but I also tried to find scholarships. And usually master's in the United States not really covered well, because it's pretty short programs. So I was like, I was like sleeping on the floor, like it's like 10 people in the room. Like, I mean, it's like the first year of my life in the United States was really harsh. I tried to be really cheap and try to minimize my expenses because I just didn't have money. But I also began working. Like, what was great is that my program employed some students. So usually like that program has 3 semesters, and each semester you have studio, you know, and you take a space project during it. And some of the projects actually related to like actual, you know, solving actual problems and working with contractors like Boeing. Some students are employed by Boeing, some students are employed by some other companies. Some students work on the like NASA competitions, so it's like not paid. So I found like a paid opportunity, and it was like really supporting my life. So, but like, especially like as you're thinking about how exactly you support your life working in space architecture, like first years, it's not going to be possible. Like it's you're really trying to find a way how exactly you can get paid. And especially like the reason why I created the company is that I could work at NASA, and I actually didn't really want, because usually when you graduate with space architecture degree, it's a systems engineering. So it's like, it's not about architecture, it's mostly about engineering. And you can go to NASA and work as a space architect, but it's going to be mostly about like connecting all these dots, like over a spacecraft, like really purely engineering. So it's going to be less about real aesthetics and mostly about like how exactly it's going to work. So I wasn't really interested. I wanted to be more like artistic expression in a way, that really this inner layer of a space shop that supports human body. And I couldn't find, way I could work. So I decided, okay, this is the time for a company, because I see the demand is upcoming for this private space stations, for, you know, private national astronauts. The National Science is going to the moon and then Mars and staying longer. And this is where design can play a huge role, as we discussed before. For private astronauts, it's all about chill, it's all about, you know, imagination. This is like the best place where designers and architects can come and work on this. So in the third question is how I sustain this interest. Well, again, so some people think that space is kind of cool, and it is cool, right? But my deepest reasoning is that I was actually never interested in space. Usually like people who join space community, they've been like wanted to be astronaut since they were like leader. I wasn't really interested in this. I wanted to be just an architect, designer, blah blah. But then I realized that like design can have a powerful like meaning. Like I think that I just, you know, I just deep down I'm really afraid that eventually we will extinct, and I'm 100% sure it's going to happen. And I wanted to make sure that humanity can stay afloat and being able to go to the moon and being able to live sustainably there. And this is, you know, from my perspective and this perspective of designers, this is where we can join the field, and this is where we can help humanity thrive. So this is how I sustain the interest, because it's been really hard. And it's still like it's much better right now, but it's still like finding projects that you can work on. It's really limited, but you just really need to create your own projects and be really like decisive on, you know, what direction you want to take. Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. That was a lot to process, and yeah, that was a very good insight into the journey. Architecture to space architecture.
Yeah. Like, what are the differences and similarities in the factors that influence space architecture and the architecture in the Earth? Can it get us through the process you go on to your projects from now?
Yeah, totally. It's a real good question. I actually wrote a paper on this. It's on my what's called ResearchGate account. You can find my name there and just see it. But basically, it's all about, you know, in architecture, you find a conceptual inspiration. For example, you think about Frank Gehry or like, I don't know, Bjarke Ingels. I mean, like star architects, Zaha Hadid. It's all about like the, like first you create the concept, like the feeling, like what exactly you want to express. And then you have designers and engineers, like first you have designers to elaborate on this vision, and then engineers make sure it can be built, right? Changing the design a little bit. Well, in space architecture, it's kind of the opposite. In so you first want to make sure that before you even start, you think about, okay, what's given, because you never, almost never you start from scratch. You know, in architecture, you can't start. You have the privilege to start from scratch if you build a building, well, almost from scratch. You still have the landscape and like the place is going to be like the legislation. In space architecture, it's really thinking about shipping in a way that, you know, what are the vehicles available, like what the rockets we're going to be using, understanding the needs, like what, so it's like really kind of this engineering based approach in a sense. So you first think about constraints. I mean, in architecture, you also think about constraints, but it's like an architecture is really new way thinking of constraints. What exactly will influence your design, right? So it's like kind of creating this, like, okay, how much space you can take, and then this is where you start, like, okay, what exactly? It's not about self-expression, honestly. It's just about like what exactly, like, what's the problem you want to solve, right? So it's like kind of this reverse thinking, and it might be like similar to industrial design in some ways, or maybe industrial buildings, like, or maybe like when you do interior renovation, you have the structure of the building, and then you have much more constraints than when you, if you didn't start without the building. So yeah, and the principles, you know, you first, like the way we work is that you really need to understand, like, what is the mission, like what exactly, how many people will go, how many suppliers you need, what's the power requirements, how much power you can use. Because I see many designs in terms of like space, they might look cool, but it might not be able, you might not be able to ever implement this because it will waste so much resources for a little benefit. So being really like frugal, going to the moon and Mars and like thinking about it as a camping in the new level, honestly, like you want to bring your own water, your own food, and it's going to be like this for the next many, many years, at least like 10 years, unless we have a sustainable living there, when you're already able to grow your food and have your own fuel, pretty much everything, but you want to bring everything with you. And design, like at this stage, I know it's not really a big priority for space companies, space agencies, but if you show that your design can solve problems and make humans more efficient and performing tasks, I'm talking about astronauts right now, national astronauts. So this can be really useful. But if it's just beautiful, which I mean can be used for private astronauts, right, too, for kind of entertainment. So again, like really understanding the purposes of the design and where you start, what are the resources. So it's I can talk all and on about it, but let's go on another question. But yeah, it was a great question.
We're moving on to the next question. So the next question, it's related to the spatial comfort of the astronauts within a space capsule. So, how relevant is the factor of claustrophobia within a space?
Yeah, that's a big thing, claustrophobia. Well, first off, I think that astronauts are not really allowed to, I mean, you don't get to go to space if you have claustrophobia, right? But again, claustrophobia is not about physical space, it's about really mental space, it's about, you know, our mind think it's like enclosed space and you can't really run away, which is actually true for space habitation. But it's you can trick your mind with like if it's space is really small, you use like light colors and also some kind of reflective surfaces to make it feel it's bigger, right? But again, like it's really something that it's, you know, claustrophobia is something that architects, designers are working on currently. And yeah, that's a big factor. Yeah.
But I wanted to add on to that in the sense mm-hmm. that when a person stays within, like they're confined to that space for a large amount of time, so wouldn't they develop a phobia over time?
That's a good question though. You see, like when you talk to astronauts and say like, yeah, they can get used to this small world surrounding them. And then when they can come back home to Earth, it looks so, feels so vast, so spacious. And this is something that you really miss, like the flow of air, like the, yeah, so I think that you can develop kind of claustrophobia, but again, like thinking about national astronauts, that haven't been the case like that. There might be some mental issues, but we're not exactly sure like what caused them. It might be, you know, claustrophobia, limited space, you know, limited privacy. Can't really be with yourself. I mean, there's some parts you can, but you pretty much, you go to work. I mean, there's your job and you work all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. This is a very interesting question. How much of what is shown in science fiction movies with respect to space architecture is true? This is the only way of me seeing the perspective, like how the space architecture is and how they live. So what do you think of this are true and which cannot happen?
Okay, I couldn't hear the last sentence you said, but can you repeat, please?
Yeah, some of the things that you wish you want to be in the next coming years and some things that wouldn't even happen.
Yeah, in terms of like sci-fi, like if we have, I mean, so your question is pretty much do we drive inspiration from sci-fi or if it's like realistic or and if it's upcoming next years, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I have some troubles with connection, I think. But basically, so you always see sci-fi, it's, I think it's kind of exaggerated. Again, like the world, like the way we think right now, like we might have limited vision of what exactly going to be possible in the future. So I can't really say a lot about it, but my vision is that space travel and space stations on the next 30 to 50 years is not going to look something like in sci-fi. It might look like something a little bit of like maybe in terms of like textures and walls, but in terms of like you know, sterile feeling of it, as you see like why it is prevalent in this space, you know, sci-fi, I think that is not going to be true, because we don't want to live like in a hospital, because we want to make sure that it feels like home. So it's like much more colorful, but it's not that vivid colors that affect the mentality, you know, kind of this hues of colors. But in terms of like speciality, like spaciousness of space habitats, again, like it's going to be limited space, unfortunately. Like it's going to be for the next like 30 to 50 years, because you can really drop price a lot. Like you can go to minimal, it's going to be like a few thousand dollars, like a kilogram, for example, and it's still expensive. So that's pretty much, I think, my answer is that we get inspired by sci-fi, but we wouldn't have like a huge ships like Star Trek, at least in the next 50 years, maybe never, because there's no necessity. I mean, I think it will make sense to have it on like on the moon and Mars, because this is where we will spend a lot of time. But being in space is like kind of transition. It's still gonna take us around like a year. I mean, 6 months travel to Mars and back, so it's like a year of travel. But it's not gonna be. Well, it's in terms of like efficiency, cost, it doesn't go that far.
So the next question is, could you tell us a little about the innovations that have been taking place in terms of construction materials? So basically, mm-hmm. the same materials that would be used in Earth would not be relevant in Mars, for example. So would you produce some construction material on site, or what would be the...
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a really good question. I believe a lot in inflatables, because it might look like it can pop really easily, but in actuality, it's really strong material. In fact, there is some fabric developed for inflatables that can reflect a lot of radiation and, you know, particles, that's something that we're really afraid in terms of like exploring moon and Mars. You probably know a lot about like there's like 3D printing campaigns is coming along. Like we want to build in situ, meaning that using local resources to build something. But I would tell you that there's really limited, like we do have like different materials that we can make on the moon and Mars, but it will take a real long time. It will take many, many missions to assemble. So basically I see it as like for the next like 10 to 20 years, it's going to be prefab structures that are sent from Earth, because it's much more efficient. And we have like on Earth, we have the biggest diversity of materials in the entire universe. I mean, entire solar system, at least as far as we know. Other planets in the solar system, they have much, much less resources available for us. So again, like Earth is something that we will take a lot of resources so far. It's like I'm telling you about the short-term future. But I'm really interested in exploring, you know, 3D printing in a scale that when it's like eventually we'll be able to live sustainably and extract materials for that. Something that's really useful. Yet the problem again with the space habitation is that it should be under a lot of pressure, like to sustain the, like in order to have humans inside of habitat, you want to have a lot of pressure. And you know, 3D printed concrete regolith doesn't work great in this case. So that's actually the reason I like inflatables, because it does work good in terms of in this direction. But in terms of if it's concrete structure, it can really apply a lot of pressure. It's it can weaken the structure. And for the structure to be really strong, it should have a lot of regolith, a really thick wall, more than that, maybe 2 pounds of regolith. So it's you should use a lot of material for the purpose of sustaining pressure inside. Which is, I think it's not really efficient. You can use water materials used for the concrete for some other purposes, which is building roads, building other infrastructure than habitats. So yeah, it might not look great outside, but it wouldn't really matter much. I mean, we want to, as we architects, we want to create something really meaningful and as a statement on the Mars and on the moon. But in reality, it might not be possible for the next many, many years. I think at least in our generation, as long as we are alive, it's not going to be possible. So again, in terms of innovation, there's many, many materials in terms of if you're talking about interior design, getting developed in terms of antimicrobial surfaces and smart surfaces. So something I really look upon, but in terms of construction, it's a really long, long-term question. Melody Yasher, who is working, at Icon as architectural lead in their yearnings of making habitats on the moon and Mars, she can tell you more about it. But I can talk more about the interior design and less about construction. But as far as I know, it's just a thing that, even though it might sound there's a lot of innovation in space, but in reality, we pretty much are restricted with the choice of materials, and we all, at least for the next 30, 50 years, we'll bring it from Earth and use it. I mean, not in situ, maybe partially in situ, but yeah, that's how it is. Guys, I actually need to go. I just see it's past 10 in California. But it was great talking to you guys. You can send me questions. I'll be more than happy to answer. And thank you again for having me. It was such a great conversation.
Thank you, ma'am. Mm-hmm. With this, we come to the end of a very interesting and inspiring evening. We would like to thank Architect Anastasia Prosina for accepting our invitation amidst a very busy schedule and sharing her experience and knowledge with us. We are sure this session will be extremely useful for aspiring space architects everywhere. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, everyone, for joining us today. We'd also like to thank our sponsors for making this happen, our travel partner, Red Taxi, our graphic design partner, Wacom, our online publicity partner, ArchiVoice, photography partner, Indian Institute of Photography, and our workshop partners, Kava, Kripochir, and Prayog. Stay tuned and follow our Instagram page at Archcult for more information on upcoming workshops, events, and guest lectures lined up for the next 2 days. Thank you.
Thank you, Adonis. Thank you, Nilan, for having me. Again, if you have any questions, please feel free to, you can forward my email to the participants. And I will be more than happy to answer them. Yeah. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Good luck. And I want to think about something inspirational, but basically the confinement, any restrictions you have, it's in your mind. So you can do anything in your life wherever you want, if you apply a lot of pressure and effort on this. So keep going, and until later. Bye, guys.
Thank you, ma'am.
Bye. Thank you.